I want to get into the word of the Lord this morning. And if you have your Bibles, turn with me to 2 Samuel chapter 6. And I want to read a couple portions of verses here to start out the message. 2 Samuel chapter 6, beginning with the 13th verse. And it says this: "And so it was that when the bearers of the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed an ox and a fatling." And verse 14: "And David was dancing before the Lord with all his might." Say that again. David was dancing before the Lord with all his might. "And David was wearing a linen ephod." And I want to speak on this thought for just the next few moments. If you were standing in that crowd, you were there in the moment, you would have probably asked this question: why is he dancing? Why is he dancing? And maybe I could even subtitle this: why are you dancing? Maybe turn to somebody, why are you dancing? Or maybe, why are you not dancing? To lay the foundation of this text this morning, you have to understand that Israel is in a difficult time. It is not a moment necessarily that things have just been on the upswing. There's been a battle. David's been in a battle, much like the battles that it seems like we have been going through in life the last year and a half or so. David, in this story, in the context of the story, you have to understand, he's just been going through the stuff. And if you're standing there and you're watching this moment, you're confused. It's like, why in the world would David be dancing? What has God into him? Has he gone mad? Has he lost his faculties? What's causing this man to dance in this moment? Because in the context of the story, we have to know this, that David's went through a lot. First, it is his closest friend, Jonathan, the one that has been beside him through thick and thin. When Jonathan's dad, Saul, the king of Israel, was coming after David's life, it was Jonathan, his closest peer, his closest confidant, that would come and even warn David, "Hey, David, my dad is angry at you, and he has plans to take your life. You're going to have to go into hiding." They made covenants. There was a relationship. There was a friendship there. And it just happened within the past few months that Saul and Jonathan had been in a battle. And in that battle, the news comes back to David, who is in hiding because Saul has wanted his life. So he couldn't be a part of this battle. And the Israelites had went out to battle. And in that battle, his friend, the news comes back, Jonathan has died. And there's a heaviness in David's heart. His hope was that God would have done something miraculous. He knew that he was anointed to be king, but he thought some possible way, Jonathan's got to be a part of this. There's got to be a piece of the puzzle that fits into my kingship, to my rulership, that Jonathan can be a part. Jonathan understands the calling. Jonathan understands the anointing. And then the tragic news that Jonathan will not be a part of the kingdom. That his life has been exhausted. That life is gone away. And if there's anything that would cause a person to mourn, is when that closest friend, that person, when you have a lot of people you work with and a lot of people that you're associated with, and a lot of people, but then there's that closest of friends that you have, and for that person to be taken out of your life, David, I know, had to wonder, who am I going to go to in my toughest times? That is part of the battle that David is facing in this moment. It's also the fact that as David now steps into the kingship, that it's the kingdom is in disarray. It's in dysfunction. It is in chaos beyond anything that they've ever seen. When there was King Saul came to power, there was an excitement, there was joy, there was possibility. We're going to be like another nation. We've got a king coming in, and there was a triumphal entry, and there was celebrations and parties and festivities, and the nation was so excited. Not so for David. David is not handed that beautiful photograph. David is handed a kingdom that there's question, there's suspicion about how this took place. And an Amalekite comes back and says that he has killed Saul. And now there's this turmoil between David's men and Saul's men on who will run the kingdom. And there's been murder, and there's been all kinds of difficulty. David is handed one of the most difficult situations, and he's trying to work out all the problems you can see when there's dysfunction and when there's struggle. And David, I can imagine, is laying at night trying to figure out, how am I going to mend such a deep wound in this nation? How am I going to pull everybody back together? This is the atmosphere. This is what David is dealing with as we read our text. Not only that, you've got the loss of a friendship, the disarray of a nation, and then you have an attack, the Philistines, in the middle of all of the other two situations that David is facing. The word comes, David, the adversary, the Philistines, you defeated Goliath once, but they're back again. That same battle that you faced over and over, it's come back at you, David, and they're lining their forces, and they're gathering people together, and they're coming to take a stand against you. And so not only has he lost his closest friend, and not only has he got disarray and dysfunction in his kingdom, he's now fighting a battle that he did not need in this moment. You ever had those times when it just seems like everything is caving in on you? Everything is coming at you at once. This is what David is facing. And then to top things off, David had desire to do something marvelous, something great for the kingdom, something that he thought would be life-changing. He wanted to bring a spiritual emphasis to his kingdom. He realizes he's hurting. He realizes his nation is hurting. He realizes there's war. So he says, you know what I need to do? I need to bring the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem. I need to make it the center of all the focus of what we do. And so in his exuberance and his excitement, he doesn't go to the Word of God, and all he wants is God's presence to be there. He thinks this can be a game changer. This can be the moment that can solidify the kingdom. This can bring some peace and strength to my life. And he goes out and he begins to bring the Ark of the Covenant back, and it's sitting on a cart just like the Philistines had moved it. David thought, you know, that's the way I can move it too. I just, God will honor it. I just want his presence. And it comes to a place where it hits a threshing floor, a place of separation. Oh, sometimes there's that moment of separation that just can be so devastating when it breaks something off in your life, something unexpected. You're searching for God. You're trying to do the right things, and then somehow God breaks one more piece in your life, and that is what happens as one of the men step out as the ark is shaking, as it hits that threshing floor where wheat would be separated from chaff. He reaches out to touch it and to secure it, and when he does, that man's life is taken in an instant. David is absolutely devastated. God, what are you doing? What is going on? Don't you see my desires? Don't you see what I long to have? I was trying, and you allowed this man's life to be taken. Where are you in the midst of all my chaos? This is the backdrop, and now you understand maybe the question, why is this man dancing? Is he deranged? Is he just missing a few screws? Why is David dancing with all the brokenness? And the question is a great question. There's sometimes it doesn't make sense to be worshiping. It doesn't make sense for somebody to be praising. You might ask, why are they doing that? Why? I can understand Miriam grabbing a tambourine. I can understand that moment that they have been in a long, long siege of the Egyptian control, and they thought they had been liberated after the 10 plagues, and they have taken their journey, and they've crossed the Red Sea, and they've looked back and watched the adversary be drowned by the waters of that Red Sea, and Miriam grabs a tambourine and begins to dance with the women, and praise goes. I can understand a praise in the middle of a victory. I can understand a praise of Joshua after he's marched around a wall 7 days and done it silently. Then on a seventh day, he marches around a seventh time, and you hear trumpets and screams and people shout, and oh, I can dance with Joshua when there's a victory, when the walls fall and you have conquered everything. I can dance with a Daniel that has set in a lion's den, and he comes out on the other side and he is unscathed. The mouths of the lions have been shut, and when he comes out, the king says, Daniel's God, he is God. Oh, we can be worshipers then. I can understand how you can worship after you've been through a fire that three of you go in and four of you come out. And the king once again says, from now on, the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that is our God. Oh, it's an easy worship, but how do you dance in the middle of your brokenness? How do you have the courage to stand when your best friend is no longer there beside you? How do you stand when your life is in disarray? How do you stand when the adversary and trouble comes at you on your job, and trouble comes into in your relationship, and it just seems like every time that you get up and every time you go to the mail and every time you get an email, there's just another piece of bad news? How do you worship in the midst of that? How do you worship when you're trying to reach for God and it seems as the heavens are as brass and shut down? How, David, do you do that? Why, David, are you dancing when it doesn't make sense? Why is he dancing? I got the answer. You see, you don't dance. You don't dance because of your circumstances. You don't dance because of your circumstances. You can dance because the circumstances change. Oh, that's great, but that's not the only reason. It's good to dance when you've sat at the gate beautiful and you've watched Jesus walk by your life time after time, and you've heard others get the victory, and you've heard the lame has walked, and you've heard the dumb has talked, and you've heard that the blind has seen, and you've heard that Lazarus has been raised, and every day Jesus walks by you and never touches you. And then you get a moment, and you have that moment when Simon Peter and James says, silver and gold have we none, but such as we have, give unto you, and rise and stand. Oh, if I'm a lame man that's been waiting for, I can see the dance then. I can see him standing in the temple going absolutely crazy. The circumstances make sense there, but when it doesn't make sense, why would you dance? Why are you dancing in difficult times? Well, David, I believe, shows us the answer. David puts it very simply. As he brings the Ark of the Covenant in the second time, and he brings it in correctly, and as the scripture was saying, every six steps they would take six paces, and they would stop, and he would call for another fatted calf, and he would call for another farthing, and they would put a sacrifice, and he would begin to praise and worship. Why is David doing that? Two reasons. And we'll be done. Two reasons we worship. Two reasons that we praise in the most difficult hours, in the most difficult times. Number one reason that David praised, he was in the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. If for no other reason, when you walked in this building, this room, you may have been going through the worst trial and the test, but you have walked into the atmosphere of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who is Alpha and Omega, who is the beginning and the end. And when you stepped into his presence, anything became possible. There is no miracle that could not happen in this moment. Do you realize when you stepped into his presence, when you stepped into this atmosphere, you stepped into the atmosphere of the ones that said, "Let there be stars," and there were stars. Do you realize you stepped into the atmosphere of the one that said, "Let there be animals, and let there be green grass, and let there be trees," and instantaneously those things came into that's the atmosphere that you stepped in. You stepped into the presence of the Almighty. And sometimes we forget how powerful, how awesome it is to stand in the presence of the one that can speak any word at any moment and can change any situation, any problem, any difficulty. In his presence is fullness of joy. I dance not because of my circumstances, but I dance because I am in the presence of the King of Kings, who is worthy. And you never, if there was a king in the Old Testament, you never, ever stood in his presence with gloom. Nehemiah spoke of that danger and how kings, if somebody would walk in and they were disheartened, they were discouraged, and the king could snap his finger, and in a moment a javelin could go through your soul and pierce your heart, and your life would be taken in an instant. In a moment you could be cast out of his court, because in the presence of the king, he didn't want anything but jubilation. He didn't want anything but praise. Do you realize they had court gestures all the way up into the 1500s, because they wanted there to be joy and happiness in the presence of the king. When you walk into this room, there should be just something that says, "I am in the presence of the majesty, the king, and I am just coming to bring to praise to him because I'm in his presence." And he inhabits the praise of his people. There's nothing that makes God any happier than a group of people that just praise him because they're so in honor, so enamored to be in his presence. You worship like David. I don't understand why he's dancing. He's dancing because that Ark of the Covenant is right in front of him or right behind him, and he realizes, "I have got the Ark of the Covenant, and blessings are coming my way. Favor is coming my way." It doesn't look like it right now, but I'm not worshiping based on what I'm feeling and what I've seen. I'm praising because God is in my midst, and God is aware of my situation, and that is when we worship. Our worship is the most powerful. So I worship in my difficult times. The best kind of praise that hits this building is when you walk in this building, that room, and you've been in the car and it was heavy driving to this place, and there's been difficulty all week, and you've been discouraged and you've been overwhelmed, and you didn't know if you could hang on for another day, but you walk through those doors and everything changes. Nobody knows that you had a problem in your job. Nobody knows that you had a problem with your boss. Nobody knows that you're struggling with your spouse. Nobody knows that you're having problems with your kids, because you walked in to this room and all of a sudden everything changed. I am in the presence of Jehovah, God Almighty, Prince of Peace. That's the kind of worship that would be, you know, so many people, you could walk in here, how you doing? Oh, it's been, no. When you walk in here, it's not fake. It's just, no, I'm choosing to forget that Jonathan's dead and Philistines are lined up against me and that adversaries, there's disarray. I'm choosing right now to focus on nothing but the King of Kings and give him all the praise he's worthy. My hope is in him. My possibility is in him. Reason one, David danced, was simply the fact he was in the presence of the King of Kings. The second reason that David danced, the second reason he danced was in that moment, he said, it doesn't matter what my conditions are, I am worshiping because my eternal destiny is secure. It doesn't matter what is going on. It does not matter the battle that I'm facing. My future is secure. At this moment, he has no covenant. He has no Davidic covenant. He has no promise. He has no temple that's going to be built. All he has is that presence of God, but there is something inside of him that says, as long as God is for me, as long as God is with me, my future is going to be okay. The steps of the righteous man are ordered of the Lord. There is joy and peace and happiness in the presence of God. Why? Because I know my future is secure. I come to a close this morning. Not a long word, but why aren't you dancing? There is no circumstance. There is no battle that should hinder your praise. There's no problem that is bigger than your God. There's no difficulty. And regardless of what you may be dealing with today, regardless of the struggles you may have felt, you're in the presence of God right now. Realize you're in his presence. It doesn't take moving to this altar. Stand with me this morning. It doesn't take some kind of superficial actions. But it has to be an acknowledgement. I worship. I praise. Not necessarily just that dancing. I'm not saying everybody has to get out. But there should be a worship and a praise because I have the opportunity. I have the opportunity right now in this moment to ask someone that can change my circumstances in a second. Where else will you be today, this week, this month, that whatever you're dealing with can be changed in 1 second? We've lost an appreciation and an understanding of where we stand. We have enlarged our battles. We have enlarged our adversaries. We have enlarged our struggles. David did not do that, did he? In that moment, what hit him? I want that spirit. I want that attitude. That as he begins that journey back, realization begins to hit his heart. And suddenly, the loss of Jonathan, it still hurts, but it just begins to shrink away in the presence of God. The loss of Jonathan gets smaller as God gets bigger. The battles of the kingdom, the battles in your job, when you get in the presence of God, should just shrink away into smallness.
in his presence, all of a sudden, all he could see was the goodness of the Lord. And something swelled inside of him. You ever felt that, had that moment where something just hit you and it was joy unspeakable? Jeremiah put it was like fire shut up inside my bones. Jeremiah lived in one of the most difficult generations of all times. He was called the weeping prophet because he would preach and he would preach and he would watch as people would yawn and stand there and there would never be a response. And he kept telling people, you got to move back towards God. You got to move back towards praise. You got to move back towards faithfulness. You got to move back. And they would just push away from it. That's just an old man telling the story to you. I don't want any part of it. And he watched as the nation was just being taken apart piece by piece. Yet as Jeremiah, in the midst of all the downcast and the difficulty, he's the one that said, I got so close to God that it was like fire shut up in my bones. There was a praise. I don't know where that praise was. It in the time in the dungeon? Was it in the time in the well? I don't know, but somewhere along the place, he just got a God that was bigger than his problems, and he began to worship God, and a fire burned into his body. I'm here to tell you, you're in that place that if within just a moment's time, he can do anything. Nehemiah understood that in that moment. He understood. I'm going to walk in here and I'm going to do something that is totally, I may lose my life. I'm heavy over the city of Jerusalem and the temple that's in disarray. It broke his heart and he walked into the king's presence and the possibility of a javelin going through him was right there. But he also knew the possibility that in the king's presence, I might get to ask just one question. I may be asked, and it was, Nehemiah, why are you so downcast? You know that's not supposed to be. My city is broken down and my country is in disrepair. Oh, really? What do you need? I need some men. I need some papers for safe travel. And King said, not only do you get some men, but here's the finances. Here's everything. Here's some utensils. The king could give him everything he needed. Why be downcast this morning? The King of Kings can give you everything you need right here in this moment. Well, I need this. No, let the king give you what you need. He knows abundantly beyond what you would ask. All Nehemiah wanted was some paper and a few men. But by the time he got done, he had camels and horses and loads of utensils to take back. He had oil for the anointing. He had fire. He had everything that he wanted because he got in the presence of the king and understood anything is possible. That's where you're at this morning, in this moment. Why do you dance? Why do you worship? It's good to be in his presence, and that's why I worship. So many times I just come into this place and there's things going on all around and the praise just goes up and there is a cleanness and there is a lightness that comes over me because I lose focus of all the things of this world. Didn't Jesus say it? If I be lifted up, I'll draw all men. I'll draw all the attention away from everything else. I'll draw everything to me. Sometimes that's just what we need. One last thing before the sing this morning. The nation was in disarray, remember? It was not only David that was brokenhearted, not only David that was hurting, but it was a nation that was hurting. It was a nation that was broken, divided. But when David started dancing, 2 Samuel chapter 6,
verse 15 says this. When David just busted out into a dance, when David just got his praise on in the midst of all his pain, when David just threw down the robes and said, forget this, I'm dancing, I'm worshiping, I'm going to act like a fool. His wife looks down on the moment and cannot believe what she's seen. She is embarrassed by his praise. What is he doing? Doesn't he realize how stupid he looks? That's what the adversary wants to tell you when you want to bring your praise, when you want to throw down your worship and dance, when you want to raise your hand. Don't do it. You're going to look foolish because your spouse knows what you're going through. Your children know what you're going through. Don't do it. Just hold your peace. David said, no, I am going to throw down all this stuff. He wasn't just throwing off the ropes of his priestly place, of his kingly place. He was throwing down the problems and saying, I am ridding myself of all the cumbersome things that are preventing me from having glory in God. I'll throw it down. And he throws it down, and people are looking, what is he doing? This place is a mess. His king's a mess. His men are fighting one another. The Philistines are out there waiting to battle, and this dude is dancing. But look what happened. Throw that verse up there for me if you can. 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 15. So David and all the house of Israel. Uh-oh. One person's praise turned to a lot of praise. You see, if we could just get a couple of people to see the majesty of the Lord and the promise that is ahead of you instead of the situation, if we could just get a couple of people to see that God is great and greatly to be praised, if you could only get a people to see this is just my temporary place, I have an eternal destination. So David and all the house, all of a sudden, one praiser turns into twos, two turns into five, five turns into ten, and ten turns, and all of a sudden, all the house that are watching going, oh, I wonder what he's doing, all start joining in, and we're bringing up the Ark of the Covenant with shouting and sounds of the trumpet. Your praise can change the atmosphere. Your praise can change the climate. Your worship right now, right this second, can turn this entire place around. What do you see? My God,
the breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see.